The world is rapidly changing and facing major global challenges. 1.5 billion people have no access to electricity. Over 1 million people lack access to safe drinking water. Some 300 million children go to bed hungry every night. In 2050, to feed 9 billion people, we will have to double food production. Climate change will cause multiple impacts on water, health, agriculture, and biodiversity. There is an increasing need for science-based solutions, especially in the developing countries. The planet needs bold and solid solutions to turn vision into reality. For millions of African peasant farmers, owning a piece of land represents their life. We're in Western Kenya, and here, in the countryside, nearly every family has one or two plots of land, each of about 1/4 acre. Land that allows them to be self-sufficient, and, if all goes well, even provides them with the supplies needed for harder times, as well as some income. That is, if the rain comes, pests don't attack, and the soil remains acceptably fertile. Conditions that are hard to control for these families, who are always hanging by a thread. Remedios Buana, in the village of Yenga, is a skilled, determined farmer who, with the fruits of his 4 small plots of land, has to provide for no fewer than 12 people, including his children and grandchildren.
With us, if you don't have land, then life is very difficult for you. In most cases, you'll find that any of the children, you have to work very hard because you have to feed many mouths. So we first see that our children are properly fed. And again, you know, with children, at the age between 1 and 5, if they are not properly fed, then their thinking capacity will be eroded. We have experienced hunger. In fact, most of the family around are food insecure because we are not producing enough to feed ourselves. And mostly when we talk of food production, mainly it is the maize. Maize is the staple food.
Despite the fact that 75% of Kenyans live off agriculture and that agricultural products are the largest component of national GDP, only 17% of the land in Kenya is fertile enough, and only 1/2 of the agricultural output is marketed. A lot still needs to be done to improve productivity and to make the land more suitable for farming. In the ISIPE Tropical Research Center in Mbita, high-level researchers are looking for the most effective ways for fighting both insects that damage crops and weeds that wipe them out. The research center is dedicated to improving the health conditions of the Kenyan population and to increasing local agricultural production by studying the tropical insects that carry diseases and infest crops.
I come originally from India, and before coming to Africa, I worked in Philippines, and I knew how people suffer from hunger and poverty. But when I came to Africa, I was amazed to see the problem of striga, which does not occur either in India or in the Philippines. And this looked that this is devastating, and the farmers will never be able to produce the food if striga is a problem. As you can see here, the crop looks very poor, and this being a parasitic weed, it has a root-to-root association with sorghum plant or maize plant, and it takes the nutrient out of the plant. And finally it dies, as you see here. The plant is dying because the nutrient is going out through the root to the parasitic weed. So this is a scenario which most of the farmers in Africa have.
Zeyo Khan has developed an innovative and sustainable agricultural technology to eradicate both Striga hemonthica, a parasitic grass, and southwestern corn borer, a moth whose larvae feed on corn and sorghum plants. Desmodium, a legume that repels the larvae and suppresses the weed, is planted in between the rows of maize. Napier grass, which attracts the larvae and kills them, is planted around the perimeter of the crops. This double action gives the technology its name, push-pull. Professor Khan's team carries out very thorough, effective fieldwork to disseminate the push-pull technology, based primarily on regular meetings with local farmers. At the center of it all are the communities and farmers who become an active part of the process of research and dissemination of the technology. They are shown how to sow the plants that kill pests naturally, between the rows of corn. No special skills or large investments are required. It is an efficient method guaranteeing a harvest of up to 10 times the size.
The plot I'm having, the first plot, I used to get only 4 kilograms of maize. But since I joined this technology of push-pull in that place, I'm getting more than 90 kilograms. I can get 1.5 sacks, which is almost 133 kilograms from the small plot. But there before, it was terrible and miserable. I use a lot of strength digging, but harvest, nothing, only 4 kilograms, which could not satisfy the needs of my family and myself.
The staple food in these areas is ugali, made with maize or sorghum flour and water. Thanks to the push-pull technology, Mary can now grow enough on her half hectare to feed her 3 children, her husband, and her 3 grandchildren. And that's not all.
I take some of my maize, the kilograms I have, few of them, and then I've introduced a feeding program to the needy children. In my school, I'm taking 35, plus my family 6, that is 40, 41, I think. There are 41 in total on my small plot.
Desmodium and napier grass, the plants used in the push-pull technology, have many positive characteristics. Besides being natural pesticides, they enrich the soil with nitrogen, making it more fertile, and they are an excellent fodder for animals.
Since I joined push-pull, I haven't suffered for hunger. First of all, the production is high. Second thing, soil erosion has stopped my land. I'm not being stabbed by stem borers. I have enough fodder for my livestock.
Today, as many as 60,000 families of small farmers in Western Kenya, like that of Jairus, use the push-pull technology. But the direct benefits affect over 400,000 people in these parts. Jairus, who used to live in Nairobi, now supports a large family with dignity, without having to resort to food aid. Professor Khan has recently been awarded a prize for his scientific research by TWAS, the World Academy of Sciences for the Advancement of Science in Developing Countries. This is an important award which gives access to a network of scientists able to make a difference to the future of the planet.
I was very happy about it and felt greatly honored that I got that TWAS prize and was among the few scientists who have given a lot of contribution to the science and to the world. So my name is among those scientists. So I'm quite happy, and that inspired me to do some more work. People who qualify for the TWAS awards and prizes are those who have lived and worked in developing country for more than 10 years. And I am one of the most fortunate ones who have lived here for 20 years.
The founders of ISIPE and TWAS, Thomas Odhiambo and Abdus Salam, both very high-level scientists from the Global South, were aware of the importance of creating a stable network of academic relationships for researchers like themselves. These shores of Lake Victoria are closely linked to a place far away from here, Trieste in Italy, where the World Academy of Sciences has its headquarters. Such distant spots on the planet are united by the shared belief that the science of the Southern Hemisphere can give great results if placed in a condition to develop properly. With this aim, thanks to the fundamental support of the Italian government, in 1983 the World Academy of Sciences, or TWAS, was founded in Duino Castle in Trieste. From that moment on, and for the next 25 years, Sudan-born physicist Mohamed Hassan was its executive director.
Well, I think it's first extremely exciting for me to be here. And I have exciting memories going back 30 years ago to the year 1983, November. The weather was just as nice as it is now, but with a little bit of sun. But it was at that occasion that the TWAS was discussed for the first time by 33 founding members who managed to come to Trieste for the foundation meeting of the Academy. The majority of countries in the developing world had no academies of science. So there was no mechanism to recognize the best and most accomplished scientists from the living and working in the developing world. And that was when Abdus Salam thought about the idea of why not having an academy that represents all the developing world, one academy that brings together the most talented and the most accomplished and the most distinguished scientists working and living in developing countries. I thought it was a challenge more than a dream, because the need was very obvious. The need to mobilize the scientific community in developing countries, especially that at that time, that was 30 years ago, the developing countries were contributing very little to international science. In fact, in terms of numbers, not more than 15% of the scientific productivity at that time was coming from the developing world, and 85% coming from the developed world or the industrialized world. And that is just the reverse of the ratio of population.
Mohamed Hassan never abandoned the fate of TWAS and remained at Salam's side in the coming years to give shape to what was to become the World Academy of Sciences today. Thanks to important insights and the need shared by many prominent scientists, TWAS's membership has grown considerably, and the opportunities for collaboration and cooperation have grown exponentially. TWAS is now made up of a handful of efficient people who, from small offices on the campus of the International Centre for Theoretical Physics in Trieste, run a complex network of relationships in the international scientific community. This institution, whose organisation is so small it's barely visible, still remains true to the ideals of its founders, the promotion of excellence and scientific expertise in the Global South. The hordes of box files stored in the corridors and offices hold many stories about the young researchers who have been given the opportunity to grow thanks to TWAS, about prestigious scientists who, through to us, can travel and meet to share experiences and create a virtuous network of knowledge. Romain Morenzi is the Academy's current director. Rwandan-born and a refugee in Burundi, he is a citizen of the world with extensive experience in scientific management.
There are countries that are still lagging behind in science and technology, in particular, in Africa. So if these countries can develop scientifically, this will make a huge impact. The issues of energy scarcity, food security, biodiversity loss, population growth, sanitation and water, all these issues are science and engineering issues.
Professor Morenzi is a concrete example of how support given to researchers in developing countries can achieve incredible results and have an exponential impact locally. Once a young maths teacher, he became the Minister of Education, Science and Technology in Rwanda, where in just 8 years he helped to revolutionize the educational and technological system. Romain had already been to Trieste years ago to attend a course in telecommunications, right there at the Abdus Salam Center for Theoretical Physics. He would never have dreamt that he would come back as the director of an academy to provide instruments of knowledge and hope to those who, like him, started from the bottom.
I was born in Rwanda in 1959. My family left for Burundi when I was 4 years old. And so my family stayed in Burundi for quite some time. In 1982, I finished my bachelor's degree in mathematics with orientation in mathematical physics. So I became a teacher for 3 years. And then I had an opportunity then later on, 3 years later, to get a fellowship to do a PhD in Belgium, which was, of course, a life-changing opportunity. I think that doctoral level researchers are very essential for a country. And I think putting up a mobility program for researchers to go in and out of the country and or in country to do a collaboration. And I think that possibility to give young scientists opportunity for merit-based research grants or recognizing young scientists is very, very important.
Since 1983, TWAS has increased its membership from a few dozen to more than 1,000 worldwide today. The members are some of the best scientists and engineers in the developing world. TWAS offers a range of opportunities to scientists in the South. Over 500 fellowships per year for PhD study and postdoctoral research. Research grants to support laboratories. A range of science exchange programs. Prestigious prizes and awards for scientific excellence. High-value science meetings. Partnerships with some of the world's most important science and science funding organizations. Its work is supported locally by 5 regional offices: Alexandria, Nairobi, Beijing, Bangalore, and Rio de Janeiro. For 30 years, TWAS has been committed to an overarching goal: help nations to science strength and excellence so that they can resolve challenges and advance human prosperity. Vitalis Wafula-Wekesa is a microbiologist who teaches at the Technical University of Kenya. Thanks to TWAS and the Brazilian National Council for Scientific and Technological Development, he was able to fulfill his lifetime dream of specializing, obtaining a doctorate in Sao Paulo, which opened the doors of research centers across the United States and Europe for him. Despite the fact that ICIPE is one of the best places to do research in Kenya, it is hard for many of these scientists to further their career or develop high-profile research due to a lack of adequate resources and continuing professional development. The only option is often that of specializing overseas. Vitalis Wekesa's PhD would have been an unattainable goal without the support of TWAS and the Brazilian Council.
When I wrote a proposal to do my PhD, it was a continuation of my research work in ICIPE. Because in ICIPE, it was the background. We laid the background to find out endomopathogens, the microorganisms that kill these pests. So when I went to Brazil, I went to work on another fungus that is so effective, but it is isolated from the spider mites themselves.
Vitalis Wikeza is engaged in research concerning biopesticides, natural and sustainable methods for fighting the pests of many edible plants. The 3 years he spent in Brazil gave him the chance to work closely with the best researchers in the field, using the most advanced technology.
University of São Paulo is the best university in South America. And the university is well-funded, well-equipped with the best professors I can think of.
Vitalis Wikeza, who recently returned from Germany, where he spent a period of research thanks to the TWAS Mobility Programme, divides his time between periods of research and teaching at the university, where the means are limited and laboratories are poorly equipped. For these students, the teaching materials are inadequate and research is an almost unattainable dream. But even for professors, who have often obtained doctorates abroad, research in the local universities is practically impossible. The road that every so often takes Vitalis home to the village where he was born, in Western Kenya, is long and winding and bumpy, just like the path he has had to follow to be where he is today.
Look like it is not possible for me to reach this level. So you see now I am like the light in this village. Everybody sees me as an example, having come from a very low, lowly and humble background, until you can also buy a car and even have enough to support the other family members and the community.
The whole community finds it exceptional that one of them has made it, because to make it here, you really have to want it with all your might. Vitalis, whose first name means full of energy, and whose surname Wikeza means born at harvest time, was one of these children. He began his schooling at the age of 10 in a primary school too far away from the interests of the capital city and international humanitarian investments.
Initially, we were many in the family. And my dad, I think, wanted some people my elder brothers to move up a little bit before I start, because he was fearing the problem of payment of fees. So I used to sit somewhere there when I was in standard 8. I know that this is a very humble beginning where you have to go through this type of situation. You pass through an environment that has no facilities, and you have to compete with students from other schools that have better facilities, because you sit the same exams. The examination is the same.
Vitalis Wikeza also attended secondary school in fits and starts, as the cost of tuition, board, lodging and books was too high for his family. It was one of the most difficult moments of his educational journey, as the school principal was merciless and sent him home on foot several times. 30 kilometers separated Vitalis from his future. But his luck was about to change. The headmaster was replaced, and his biology teacher supported him, feeding him at his own home and providing him with additional books to reinforce his passion for science. The students gather around him to ask for advice and to find out how he worked his way up.
So when I got the information that I've been nominated to be given a scholarship to study for PhD, I remember even that night I could not sleep. I was so excited that I could not even sleep. Yeah, it was amazing, I tell you. I think this is the best thing that has ever happened to me in my life. To get a scholarship to go abroad and study for my PhD.
A source of great pride for his mother and father, Vitalis is also a great help for the whole community. He recently built a brick house for his parents. He buys medicines and luxury goods such as rice and soap. He provides for the small needs of relatives and friends in the village and pays the school and university fees for the children of the teachers who helped him in his studies. Nairobi is one of the most important cities in Africa, both politically and financially. It has a density of 4,500 inhabitants per square kilometer. It is chaotic and teeming with people. Today, 40% of Asians and Africans live in cities. In less than 10 years, the vast majority of the megacities in the world will be in the Southern Hemisphere. The growth rate is higher in urban areas in Africa, where 225 million people will be living in cities in 2020. Nairobi is a striking example of the growing urbanization in developing countries and also of their uneven economic growth. The new generation of Kenyans flock there seeking their fortune or merely to find a way to get by. But in cities like Nairobi, work is scarce. Food and education are more expensive. The sanitary conditions are poor. There is no network of community social support, and the lack of security is endemic. Doing research of a good standard in Africa means helping to find concrete solutions to these problems. 80% of infectious diseases in developing countries are caused by contaminated water. Even Nairobi suffers from high water pollution and poor access to safe drinking water.
The river you are seeing here is called River Nairobi. It's a river which cuts in the midst of the town, and it serves almost more than a half of the Nairobi, population. People who live in informal settlements, normally they have their earning is so little that they cannot afford quality water.
Yeah, I'm living just here, nearby here. This water helps us a lot in drinking, washing clothes, domestic use, helps us a lot.
Many of the inhabitants in this informal settlement drink the water from Nairobi River. After collecting it in makeshift containers, they leave it to stand for at least an hour so they can drink the most transparent and apparently clean water left on the surface.
because of using it in drinking, it causes pain in stomach. Because after every 2 weeks, abdominal pain because of this water.
Thanks to the support of TWAS, Professor Peter Senguto has recently been able to purchase a kit for the electrochemical analysis of water for his laboratory in the chemistry department of the University of Nairobi. These instruments are not available locally and, even more importantly, they are financially inaccessible.
My students are trying to develop devices, very simple devices. In chemistry, we call them sensors, which can be able to monitor, or be able to detect the toxic components in water, either in drinking or water for domestic use generally. Before I got the grant, I did not have even a single, working tool. So with the TWAS grant, I was able to buy the most important tool, the most important machine, called a potential stat, which can help me carry out all electrochemical studies in my laboratory. But before then, honestly, I did not have anything. So it's like TWAS has given me legs to start walking, a background to stand on.
The University of Nairobi is the oldest and the largest in Kenya. It is the young people living on university campuses like this who one day can become hydraulic, civil, and electronic engineers, or agricultural scientists, able to change the destiny of developing countries. If only they were given the opportunity to do high-level research and specialize where there are resources of knowledge and technology. The Becker Ilri Hub is an international research center of excellence for biosciences in the field of agriculture, founded and directed for several years by Segenet Kelemu, an Ethiopian expert in plant diseases. Here, each Friday morning, all the researchers and staff at the center meet up for the coffee break. It is an important moment of community that brings together those who believe in the importance of doing research in Africa for Africa, a commitment long felt by Segenet Kelemu, recently appointed as the first woman to head ISIPE.
These are just regular laboratory, or training laboratory where a number of African young scientists come and get training. So we have a variety of equipment, including sequencing machines, incubators, PCR machines, almost all first-class equipment that you can find in Europe or in North America, you can find it here. And we have trained personnel to operate the machines, and we train a number of Africans annually. If the Becker laboratories were not here, they would have had to travel to abroad to get the same type of training and access to this equipment. Capacity in science is crucial for this to developing, to being food secure. So unless we develop the capacity of Africans in-house to solving their own problems, I think we'll never be food secure.
Over the last 20 years, Segenet Kelemu's research and that of the team under her leadership have been of great help for agriculture in Latin America, Africa, Asia and North America. Segenet Kelemu, once again a pioneer among women scientists in agriculture, was recently awarded the TWAS Prize for Scientific Research.
I think TWAS is doing a fantastic job in linking all the developing country scientists in many different areas. I was really surprised, astonished to see the magnitude of people when I went to receive the award in China. So the magnitude, the variety of sciences, level, the quality of people, older generation, younger generation, it was phenomenal.
The stories of Segenet Kelemu, Vitalis Wekeza, Peter Senguto and Professor Khan give value to the work TWAS has been doing for 30 years and give hope to the future of the planet.
Africa has a lot of resources, has 60% of the arable land. So you cannot explain why Africa should have food security because the arable land is so. So if you combine science and technology and market, it is possible to be able to make sure that Africa as a continent is hunger-free. Same with water. Africa has water, in particular Central and Southern Africa, they have water. But it does not mean that every African has access to water. So we think that TWAS can be a broker to the developing world, linking with the developed world to be able to address these challenges.